bleeding purple and gold. From the heart of Los Angeles, this is the LakersNation.com podcast with your host, Trevor Lane.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to today's show. As always, we're powered by CLNS Media and LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. Today's show is brought to you by Robinhood. Head over to Lakers.Robinhood.com to get free stock. I'm going to be talking more about that a little bit later in the show, but trust me, guys, you are going to want to check it out. Lakers.Robinhood.com. Get free stock. So things for in the world of the Los Angeles Lakers are, well, not going so well. Lonzo Ball is going to be out for quite a while. We're going to talk a little bit about that. We're also going to talk quite a bit about the NBA trade deadline. And joining me today is Yahoo Sports and Real GM and Celtics blog. He's all over the place. Keith Smith. Keith, thanks so much for hopping on here with me.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
So, Keith, I guess first we'll get the painful part out of the way for us Lakers fans. We'll talk about what's going on with Lonzo Ball. Of course, he gets hurt the other night against the Houston Rockets. As soon as he turned his ankle there, it looked bad. It was not a good one, and you could tell that. And it's now we're hearing that it's a grade 3 sprain. The Lakers say he's going to be out 4 to 6 weeks. I think personally it's going to be a bit longer than that, even just because they've been so cautious with him historically and he hasn't been a super fast healer. So I think it's going to be quite a while since we've seen Lonzo Ball. And so one thing I wanted to touch upon real quick was I've seen some people mentioning that maybe the Lakers could get a disabled player exception. So can you fill us in on how that would work and actually why that can't work?
Yeah, for sure. Well, the number one reason it can't work is Lonzo Ball is not going to be ruled out for the season. They're saying 4 to 6 weeks, which, you know, that is a while, but that should have him back here middle of, you know, March at the worst, I guess, you know, if you're looking at it, you know, from a pessimistic point of view. So in order to qualify for the disabled player exception, you have to petition the NBA. The NBA puts the case in front of what they call the fitness to play panel, and then they determine if it is substantially more likely than not that the player will not return this season. If that's the decision that they make, then you are eligible for the disabled player exception, and then the NBA will grant it. The other challenge is we're past the deadline to apply for that. That was, you know, about a week and a half or so ago that teams had to put in for a disabled player exception. So combine the two, they're not getting one. This is going to be one of those where it's, you know, kind of suffer through it and figure it out and make it work. Now, I will say there's another thing that often gets confused. We saw this with the Denver Nuggets earlier this year. The Nuggets had, you know, at one point, I think they had 6 or 7 guys injured that were out. And when you have 4 or more players out for what is going to be at least 2 weeks, the NBA can grant you an additional roster spot. That's the hardship exception. It's just an additional roster spot, basically, so you can have enough healthy bodies to practice and play games. So that's what happened with the Nuggets. I've already seen a couple of people like, hey, how do we get one of those? You know, you really don't want one if you're the Lakers because it means you're even more banged up than you already are. So it's, you know, not something you want to do because they're you know, obviously still down LeBron. They're still down Rondo and now Lonzo Ball, but they don't have any other injuries that I'm aware of unless, you know, somebody else is out that I'm missing. And that is, you know, you got to get to that fourth guy. So it's kind of a, you know, mixed bag. You don't want to be there because you don't want to have that. So it's really just going to be make it work as best you can with the guys you got and, you know, get after this thing.
Yeah, unfortunately, the Lakers can't qualify for that disabled player exception. You look at their roster. Obviously, it's a full roster. They have all 15 slots filled plus the two-way contracts. But interesting that you bring up the fact that they've got 3 guys out hurt right now. We've got Rondo and LeBron and Lonzo, which of course, just being the luck that the Lakers have had over the recent years, those are the guys that you can't miss. And you look at at who's been hurt, who's been out for the Lakers recently. It's been JaVale McGee. It's been Kyle Kuzma. It's been Rondo. It's been LeBron. It's been Lonzo. All these guys that absolutely can't get hurt. And you look at the playoff race in the West, and I was thinking this a month, 6 weeks ago before these injuries really started. And I thought, gosh, you know, it's so tight in the Western Conference right now that a few injuries here and there could really swing things. And unfortunately, it looks like the Lakers were the team to get hit by this injury bug. And you just got to hope at this point that they can kind of somehow hang in there and at least make the playoffs in the Western Conference, because I think that's even in doubt at this point.
Yeah, absolutely. That's that's one of the things that I've been saying for really, it feels like almost since the beginning of the season. As you mentioned, it's right now. I looked at it this morning from 3 through 10 is only 3.5 games separating those, eight teams. Mm-hmm. So that is really, that's just crazy. There's been very little separation, created in the West. Golden State and Denver have pulled away a bit at the top. And then at the bottom, we're starting to see, I think, some of the teams we expected are starting to fall out of things here. But really, it's one of those things where two things in the West was what I've held to was you win, 3 or 4 games in a row, lose 3 or 4 games in a row, and you might change, 6 spots in the standings. And it's going to be, unfortunately, as it is whenever you're in these tight playoff races, a big injury or two is going to swing things and really, cause a team to either fall out or some other team's going to take advantage and move up. So that's the tough thing right now. And as you said, those are the three guys who are out, Ball, James, and Rondo. They're really the three best point guards on the roster.
Right.
And that, and that's arguably still the most important position in basketball. So, it is a bummer. And one of the things I looked up, because I was, I'm not a doctor and I don't really play one on TV. So I looked it up to really understand what are these, ligaments and, in the ankle and what causes a grade 3. And a grade 3, in all the research I found, it's a full tear of an ankle ligament. So, that means you're going to be down for a while. That's why it's 4 to 6 weeks, because I think a lot of people are saying, why is it why is it so long for a sprained ankle? Well, that's why. It's actually a tear of the ligament. So it sounds like that's the reason why Ball's going to be out for, as long as he's going to be out.
Yeah, I would absolutely be shocked. I mean, pleasantly, but I would be completely shocked if he was actually back in 4 weeks. When you look at what this injury is, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised at all if it was more than 6 weeks. And again, like you said, I'm not a doctor. I'm not going to guess on that. And of course, Lonzo is probably going to heal faster than just the average person would, because he's going to have access to the top training and everybody that can help him recover. But still, I would actually be a little bit surprised if he was back in 6 weeks. And really, the unfortunate part of this is that it felt like, for so long, fans had been so polarized on Lonzo Ball. There was the Lonzo fans that believed in him, and then there were the other fans that said, oh, he's a bust. He's not playing well. He was shooting horribly. These last few weeks, it felt like he finally got it. Things were clicking. He was leading the team. He was the engine behind the Lakers' fast break. It was all the things that we thought we were going to see out of Lonzo Ball. And of course, the injury bug has to strike right now. So that's frustrating for Lakers fans. Now, you do mention the standings, and they are so tightly packed right now. Does this then give the Lakers incentive, and we'll segue here into trade deadline talk, does this give the Lakers more incentive to go out there and make a move and try to find somebody to give them that little burst to make it into the playoffs?
Yeah, I think it gives them some, because I don't think there's any desire to go all in to make the playoffs this year. I don't think that's the mindset. That's never the sense I've gotten, all the way back even to the summer. I think they expected, hey, we're going to be competitive. We think we'll make the playoffs, and as, if you've got LeBron James, you should probably feel that way. But it is, now it's a question, but I think they're looking at it from a standpoint of, well, Rondo should be back pretty soon. James should be back pretty soon. Sounds like we're less than 2 weeks on both of those guys, hopefully.
Yeah, it could be any day, really, at this point.
Yeah, really. Yeah, I think it's, I think 2 weeks is the extreme far end before, right, we'd see either one of them. So I don't think you want to overreact too much, because then you've got, now you've got your two ball handlers back that you really need, and, Lance Stevenson can pitch in. But one thing it may cause them to do is look at, All right, well, we've got Alex Caruso on a two-way. He can come up and, you know, help a little. I would expect that. I know they're playing later today, as we're recording this on Monday.
Right.
I think they're playing the Warriors tonight, right?
Yes. So. Yeah, yeah. Good yeah. timing. They get the Golden State Warriors tonight, and the Lakers don't have a point guard right now. Yeah,
talk about kicking you when you're down, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I would expect Caruso to be active for that game and, you know, available to help out with the ball handling a little bit. But I think there's a chance maybe they use one of those contracts of a guy who's, you know, kind of in and around the fringes of the rotation, maybe a Michael Beasley mm-hmm. kind of guy, or, you know, it's tough because
maybe Lance Stevenson.
Lance Stevenson.
Guys, right.
Okay. Yeah. Somebody, one of those guys who's there, but those guys are all kind of playing. So it's a little hard, but I do think they're probably going to want to get another point guard in there, because Rondo at this point, with his own injury history and the fact that it's just, you don't want to be having to say, okay, Rondo, go play 40 minutes a night and we'll call together the other, you know, 8 to 10 minutes behind you. I wouldn't be surprised if they swing a move to get a point guard. Now, what's the question is who, right? That's what you're going to have to look at and say, like, who is it? Because they're obviously not going to take on anybody with money that's owed beyond this year. They're going to want somebody expiring and then, you know, figure it out. And then the other option, and I know I'm going a little long here, so I'll shut up in a second. But the other
no, you're good, Keith. This is good stuff.
The other option is, you know, maybe they look at, you know, just flat waving somebody and going out to, you know, kind of the free agent scrap heap and bringing a guy in on a 10 day or two and, you know, saying, hey, let's try one of those guys out, because it's, you know, it's again, it's whatever the Lakers do, it's not going to involve taking on money for next year, because it's just not going to be that superstar guy who's going to change their free agent plans. It's going to be very much a Band-Aid to get through these next, you know, month and a half.
Well, let's talk about that. Who is out there that's potentially on the market, kind of panning back and looking at the NBA trade deadline, which, by the way, everybody, is February 7th. So we've got about 2.5 weeks here until the NBA trade deadline. Who do you see as being out there on the market? I know the first name that pops into my head, and I did write up a piece for Lakers Nation all about this, about guys they could target, but the first name that pops into my head is Jeremy Lin with Atlanta. It seems like they'd be motivated to move him, wouldn't they?
Yeah, absolutely. Atlanta is, you know, more than happy to listen on Lin, and it's no indictment on Lin and his play. He's looked good in his return from his own injuries. He's healthy. He's playing really well for the Hawks, but the Hawks don't, you know, it's funny. We always say, you know, having a really good closer on a bad baseball team is a luxury that you don't need.
Right.
And it's really the backup point guard that's really good on a bad basketball team is just something you don't need. It's, you know, that, you know, 15, 20, 25 minutes a night just doesn't really matter enough to make it worth it. So yeah, a guy like Jeremy Lin, now that's swinging a little bigger because he is owed some pretty significant money.
I think it's
so
10
you're
million?
Probably yeah, it's a little more than that. It is 13.8.
Oh, 13. He was higher than that.
Yeah, so you're looking at that point. That's probably a Kentavious Caldwell Pope would have to go out in that situation. So that's, you know, maybe right. That I could see something there if the Lakers threw him maybe a second round pick or something like that to, you know, sweeten the deal for Atlanta. Because Atlanta, the challenge is, it's not that Lin is necessarily worth that, but Atlanta has other suitors. So the Lakers are going to have to beat them. Mm-hmm. You know, the other names that kind of jump out at me, and these, it's, you know, people are going to listen to this and be like, oh, great. You know, these guys are all great. Well, you're not getting somebody great, right?
This is a stopgap, folks. This is just somebody to fill in for a little bit. This is the substitute. This isn't, you're not going to go, you know, home run swing here and land some super. It's not going to be, Damian Lillard or anybody like that.
No, exactly. Yeah. It's not going to be Damian Lillard. You're not going out there and getting, you know, anybody, you know, super big name. So I'm looking at guys like Shelvin Mack or, you know, Raymond Felton, Devin Harris, Trey Burke, Jose Calderon. Those are the kind of guys you're really kind of looking at, you know, that they're veterans who know what they're doing. You can come in, you can plug them in for, you know, if Rondo takes a little while longer, you know, for into the starting role and get by and be just fine. And then when it's Rondo and whoever, the guy you acquire behind him, you know, you're going to be okay with those guys. Just again, the key thing is they're all expiring contracts. So they're, you know, no harm, you know, going forward into next season. That's going to be the kind of guys you're looking at is, you know, those those kind of guys, or a, you know, maybe even a Tim Frazier or Devin Harris, if, you know, the Mavs or the Pelicans are like, all right, yeah, you know what, we're done. Well, let's move on. So that's really where you're looking. You know, maybe you get one of those guys and you say, all right, let's go and, you know, figure this out for the next month or so, and, you know, hopefully we can, you know, stay close enough that, you know, it doesn't matter, and then we've got that little extra depth for the rest of the season.
We're going to take a quick break to talk about Robinhood, which is an investing app that lets you buy and sell stocks, ETFs, options, and cryptos all commission-free. I'm so excited about this one. I use this app every single day. Robinhood makes investing so, so easy. I absolutely love them. They strive to make financial services work for everyone, not just the wealthy. It's a non-intimidating way for stock market newcomers to invest for the first time with true confidence. It's simple and intuitive. They have a clear design with data presented in an easy to digest way. And that was huge for me, really, because I was fairly new to stocks when I first started with Robinhood, and it just made the whole process so simple. It took away all of the uncertainty, all of the unknown factors out there where you felt like you were just diving into the deep end with a lot of different companies. Robinhood makes it very, very simple. They're right there with you, helping you. Now, other brokerages will charge up to $10 for every trade. Robinhood doesn't charge commission fees. So you trade stocks and keep all of your profits. It's super easy to use. They give you charts and market data. All you have to do to place a trade is just four taps on your smartphone, and that's it, and you're good. The Robinhood web platform also lets you view stock collections like the 100 most popular sectors like entertainment, social media, and curated categories like female CEOs and analyst ratings of buy, hold, or sell for every single stock. You learn how to invest as you build your portfolio. You can discover new stocks and track your favorite companies with your personalized news feed. And they give you custom notifications for price movements so you never miss the right moment to invest. I love this. They pop up on my phone, tell me when something's down, when something's up. It's great. Robinhood is giving my listeners a free stock. That's right, free stock like Apple, Ford, or Sprint to help build your portfolio. Sign up at Lakers.Robinhood.com. Again, that's Lakers.Robinhood.com. Get your free stock. Guys, you will not regret it. Go check it out, Lakers.Robinhood.com. Right, I could very easily see something like that happening where they just go out there and they just find somebody that can fill in short term and that isn't going to affect you long term. And really, I think this team needs a third point guard. You know, they went into the season with just Rondo and just Lonzo at the point guard spot, figuring, hey, we've got Lance who can handle the ball a little bit. LeBron is going to have the ball a ton, and we've got these other guys, but I still think they need a legitimate point guard to help with, especially with that second unit. Obviously, LeBron can handle a lot of the initiating on the offensive end when he's back, but right now he's not, and so I think they could use somebody else. Keith, one guy I want to bring up, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about just the trade deadline for the NBA as a whole, but, and maybe this will be, maybe we'll get to predict a little bit here, because something's going to happen with him soon. Carmelo Anthony is, the Houston Rockets are doing something with him today, and maybe by the time we publish this, he's moved somewhere else, but what do you predict is going to happen there? Because the Lakers continue to be linked to him. Now, he's not a point guard, so maybe there's not as much incentive as there was a few days ago to go out there and make something happen to get him. But what's your feeling on that whole situation?
Yeah, so you said it. There's going to be something that, you know, maybe happens today, and, you know, maybe not. We'll see. The reason why is the Rockets are going to sign Kenneth Faried, who was bought out over the weekend by the Brooklyn Nets. They're going to bring in Faried as they need help up front in the worst way. It's Nene and really nothing else that's a, you know, reasonable facsimile of a big. So that's why they're making that move. But they don't have the roster spot, so there's really two ways the Rockets can go with this. It's either waive Carmelo Anthony or trade him away for, you know, nothing, which really means, you know, giving him away and probably giving up a pick for somebody to eat his contract or whatever, similar to what they had to do with Michael Carter Williams a couple weeks ago.
Right.
Or the other option is that the Rockets cut James Nunnally loose, who's on a 10-day, but the challenge is Nunnally's actually playing and filling a role. So I I think it's got to be coming to a head with Carmelo. The challenge why a lot of people said, why won't they just waive him? Well, the Rockets are really deep in the luxury tax. And if they just waive him, they have to eat the entirety of his contract, which is very small. But in terms of real dollars for them, it's like $3 or $4 million. And that's not something their ownership really wants to do. They're not just wanting to say, all right, get him out of here. We'll eat this money and go for this extra. So they're trying to move him. Challenge with the Lakers has been, the Lakers would have to send something back. And that's exactly what the Rockets are trying to avoid. They, right. they want to dump him on a team who's got an open roster spot. They don't have to take anything back. It'd be a a fake pick or draft rights to some guy who's never coming to the NBA or something like that.
A top 55 protected second rounder is what we would see.
And this is just a good education point for anybody listening. If you see a top 55 second round top 55 protected second round pick goes out, that is as fake a fake pick as it gets, because you're even if you do end up giving it up, it means your season went really, really well and you're okay to say, all right, we're good. We gave up one of the last few picks in the second round. So it's really interesting. Now, as far as Carmelo and the Lakers go, I don't see it. I don't get it. I don't think it makes sense. It's one of those things, but LeBron just keeps kind of adding fuel to the fire. It feels like he I think he's looking out for his buddy and, hey, maybe he can help. Here's the challenge. Maybe LeBron is the guy who gets him to come in and say, hey, 15 minutes a night off the bench, you do your thing, and off we go. Maybe that's okay. And to be honest, I don't think he's any worse in that role than, say, a Michael Beasley is or even a Lance Stephenson. I think the Lakers would be okay with Carmelo there. I think he could still do that. Challenge is if Carmelo starts feeling like, well, I should start over Kyle Kuzma or I should start over Brandon Ingram or something like that. That's when it all gets messy and falls apart. So that's the only problem. And, maybe LeBron is that guy who can get him there. But we all said that Chris Paul will get him there. He's his buddy too. He'll make him understand, and they could make it work in Houston. So I don't know. I don't see it, but I always kind of live by the, if there's some smoke, there's probably some fire, and there's an awful lot of smoke with this one.
Yeah. It's amazing. I mean, even you probably saw Instagram the other day, LeBron liked a photo that was himself, and then Carmelo Anthony photoshopped into a Lakers jersey standing side by side. And he went and liked that photo. Clearly he likes the idea of bringing in Carmelo, but I agree with you. I think I ran a Twitter poll yesterday, asking whether fans would rather have Carmelo Anthony than Michael Beasley, which one you'd get. And overwhelmingly, Michael Beasley won. And I understand that, but I still think Carmelo can do those things, can provide that scoring. And right now, the Lakers kind of lack some scoring punch. I'm not as down on him as a player as some are, but I think you hit the nail on the head. It's the chemistry thing. Can he do what Vince Carter has done? Except that he's no longer the guy that he was and that he's a role player, and be okay with that and play for the love of the game and to help the young guys and do all of those things and fit into a role and understand that you're not going to be the superstar. It's not an easy transition to make, right? I mean, it's hard.
It is. It's one of the hardest things to do in sports when you've been the man for your entire career and now you're told you're not. Go sit there and kind of just be a support player. That's just not it's so hard for these guys to adjust to that. It's one of those things where it's unfortunate, but you talk to a lot of retired players and a lot of them will tell you is I couldn't adjust. And I ended up out of the league 2, 3, 4, 5 years even earlier than I probably could have been. Because I wouldn't make that adjustment. Now we've seen Vince Carter, he's in what, year 20 or whatever it is. He's 41 years old.
It's insane. Who would have thought? I'm sorry to cut you off, but who would have ever thought that Vince Carter, of all people, the guy who just has springs in his legs and is flying through the air, that's the guy that's playing till 41. I never, ever in a million years would have guessed that he'd still be out there at 41.
No, absolutely. And especially with the way it ended in Toronto, where it ended so ugly, and he was one of those, he got that label of being selfish and only caring about himself and all that. Now here he is, he's one of those vets that every team's like, man, I want a guy like Vince, to be around here and helping the kids. And the funny thing is, when he gets his rare opportunity to play, he's usually fairly productive. It's not for more than, 5-10 minutes, but, he goes out there and helps. And that's the thing, so he's hung on here for probably an additional 3 years already that he probably shouldn't have. And now you're looking at it as Vince's, you know, is he still got another 2 or 3 years in?
Right.
You know, because he made that transition. If Carmelo can't do that, then yeah, then if you're another team, the last thing you want is a guy, especially if you're a team like the Lakers, who, let's just say things continue to kind of go as they are and they miss the playoffs. Well, at least you're in the fight all year and your young guys got really good experience of being in the fight. The last thing you want is a guy like Carmelo coming in and kind of getting in everybody's ear and saying like, hey, I should be in there over Kuzma. We would have won that game. And then does he start to, you know, the JaVale McGee's and the Rondos and the Stevensons, do they start to say, yeah, you know, man, we need the vet on the floor, not these kids, you know, or something like that. And that's the last thing you need at this point if you're, you know, if you're the Lakers. So it's really one of those where it's, if you are convinced that he will come in and he will say, I'm good, I can play the role Beasley's playing and probably be an upgrade on what he's giving you, then take the shot. It's going to cost you nothing. But if it comes in and it goes bad, I would make sure you can immediately move away and say, I'm done. And that probably, unfortunately, you know, I know we all pick on it and say LeBron's the GM or whatever team he's on, but that's a guy you got to get to say like, hey, if we sense this is not working out, we're moving on from it immediately and getting on to something different. And he has to be bought into that.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and you've got to be 100% convinced that he is bought into the team concept and all of that. So there's a lot of things that would have to happen. I mean, he would have to somehow prove that he is willing to take on that kind of a role. And I don't know if he's willing to do that, but it's going to be interesting nonetheless to see what ends up happening with Melo here as the Rockets have to come to some sort of resolution with him and his deal. Keith, let's talk about the trade deadline as a whole. This is, again, coming up. We've got about 2.5 weeks. Do you see this as being a fairly active trade deadline, or what do we think is going to happen here? I think that there's some really interesting teams in here that could be sneaky trade candidates.
Yeah, man, Trevor, you hit on the like million-dollar question. It's this is what I have been asking team. I think anybody who's, you know, involved in the kind of the side of the game around roster building and all that, like I am, this is a question we're all asking everybody. You know, is, hey, well, what are we going to see? Is this going to be, you know, a busy deadline? Is this, you know, not going to be a busy deadline? And the answer, like, unfortunately, we're getting back is, I don't know. It's in part of the challenge is that, like, we went through it, right? You've got 10 teams still squarely in the Western Conference playoff race. You could even expand that out to as many as 13 teams if you look at just the chase for the eighth spot. You know, Dallas and New Orleans have fallen off a little, and now Anthony Davis is hurt, and I think Dallas is starting to come around to what they are. It's, you know, maybe they're going to fall out of it, but those teams are still in it for now. And then in the East, you have a full, you know, going into the eight spot, you've got 11 teams challenging. That's more teams than we usually have in it. You know, there's only a handful of teams that have already, this is it, we're done. It's, you know, we're tanking, we're moving on. This is not, you know, our year. So the challenge becomes there when you have that many teams that are still fighting for the playoffs, they're not as likely to just say, all right, you know, let's you know, give up on this and let's give up some guys. The other thing is when you look at what those teams are, teams like Orlando and Sacramento that haven't been in the playoffs in forever, they would love to make it. Now, they're not going to do anything that harms their long-term future because they're set up too well for that. So they're not going to make these all-in moves that involve trading away a ton of young pieces. But I think you're going to see those teams try to go. What my sense I'm getting is we're going to see moves because, again, these teams are all – we can go for this. Mm-hmm. We're going to see some moves from some of the top teams to kind of shore up their rotations and fill some things out there because I think teams feel like Golden State is gettable. I think they think, hey, Houston almost did it last year. We can get there. We can beat these guys if we get that chance. And in the East, it's LeBron's not there anymore. So right. It's, you know, those top five East teams are like, why not us? Like, we can be the team to step forward and take that spot. So I think you're going to see that. But what we're going to see is it's going to be, for those really good teams, it's going to be little moves around the edges of the rotation to fill things out. And then for some of the other teams, it's going to involve, hey, my expiring deal in something for your expiring deal, who's actually a good player, and we'll go. I really, you know, I know we're still a couple weeks out from the deadline, but it's going to be a big couple weeks because if Orlando falls out of this, if let's say they have another bad week and now, you know, a week from today we talk and they're six games out, they're gonna be willing to then at that point entertain moving guys and selling off pieces. If that's, you know, what happens with New Orleans or Dallas, you know, all of a sudden, all right, we're out of it. You know, let's just call it what it is and move in a different direction. Now, if they go the other way, now all of a sudden they're buyers. You know, all right, let's go get some stuff and let's move. So it's going to be one of those where, you know, it's because half the league is poised to have cap space this summer. It's one of those where the NBA is a funny game because it's, you're always looking at this year with more than an eye, you know, a very, you know, trained eye on next year and beyond, because the worst thing you can do to your fans is screw up your future because you made an ill-fated run at the playoffs this season.
Right. Yeah, that can definitely change things for you moving forward, because you can make a bad trade. I mean, fans are always clamoring for trades. Sometimes the best trade is the one that you don't make, because you can really mess things up moving forward. But I'm glad that you mentioned the Orlando Magic. I think they are – I know you're based out of Orlando, but I think they are the team to watch here. Because if they decide to start selling off pieces, I think Nikola Vucevic is the top guy that's gettable out there that's on an expiring deal. And I think that's going to be attractive to a lot of teams.
Yeah, you're exactly right. They've got three guys that teams that are hoping to make moves, are hoping Orlando falls out, because three guys that teams are looking at is Nikola Vucevic, Terrence Ross, and Jonathan Simmons. Mm-hmm. Teams are looking at those three guys. Again, Vooch and Ross are both expiring contracts, and then Simmons is what I like to call a pseudo-expiring. He's got $1 million guaranteed next season, so that's not going to hurt you one way or the other. So those three guys – now, right now, Orlando's looking the other way. They're still in this thing, and trust me, as you mentioned, I am based in Orlando. They want nothing more than to make the playoffs. Now, they're not going to go trading Jonathan Isaac for some minor upgrade to make a one-year playoff appearance. That's not going to happen.
Right.
But if they can make some moves around the edges, bring in a couple more vets, and bring in these guys, they're happy to do it. Because the other thing with the Magic is they may re-sign Nikola Vucevic this summer, because Mo Bamba – well, he's got all the potential in the world. He's not ready. He's not ready to be a starting center probably even next season. It's probably year, you know, 3, maybe even year 4 for him. He's just that raw.
Don't say he's 2 years away from being 2 years away.
No, I won't go with that one, but he is still pretty raw, you know, because he can help on, you know, some things right now, but there's times when, you know, this season he's looked completely lost. So Orlando would love to bring back Vooch, and it's funny. I think we all collectively forget Vooch spent his rookie year with Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. But it's really like Orlando's been the only NBA home he's really ever known. He is as close to a franchise player as the Magic have, which probably is why the Magic aren't very good, because Vooch is a good player, but if he's your number one franchise guy, you're probably in trouble. But I think Orlando is looking at this as saying, hey, we're not done with this guy. You know, we're happy to have him. We love Nick. You know, we want to keep him around. So it's just going to be one of those things where we're going to see, you know, where this lands up. But you're absolutely right. Teams are looking around them. Now, I had two different teams tell me last week, would they just lose, like go on a 3 or 4 game losing streak already and trade these guys, because there's guys we want there and like we're ready to move, and every time we call them, instead the conversation turns around to, well, hey, are you willing to give that guy up to us, because they're still trying to make a run.
Right. Yeah, a lot of teams can talk themselves into, hey, if everything goes right, we can make the playoffs. I mean, it's the same reason why people buy lottery tickets. Hey, all I need to do is get these six numbers, and then boom, I'm a millionaire. It could happen. Not to say that, you know, Orlando can't make a run like that or anything like that. Obviously, they beat the Lakers twice this season, but teams can. And go ahead.
Sorry to interrupt you, but you can really talk yourself into making those runs when you play in the Eastern Conference,
right?
Because that might only involve winning 35 to 38 games. Might be, all right, hey, if we win 38 games, we're there. We're in the playoffs. So it's a lot easier than, you know, say the West. If you're, you know, if you're the Dallas Mavericks, who are sitting around a similar record to Orlando, you might look at it and say, oh man, what a hill to climb. You know, and Orlando's like, yeah, good week, and we're right there.
Right. Yeah, that's all it takes, really, because the East is so wide open, and it doesn't, you know, I don't want to dive into the whole, should it just be a straight top 16 teams make the playoffs and get rid of conferences or whatever. But yeah, there's going to be, most likely, there's going to be better teams in the West that don't make the playoffs and weaker teams in the East that do, just based on the way the conferences are aligned and the quality of those teams and everything. The other squad that is going to be an interesting one to watch. They've lost five in a row here, and they just made the Memphis Grizzlies. They just made a somewhat win now trade to go get Justin Holiday. But now they're sitting at second to last in the Western Conference. You got to wonder, are they going to finally pull the trigger and give up Marc Gasol and Mike Conley? And can they even do it? I mean, given the contracts those guys have, it's going to be really interesting to see if the Grizzlies are willing to pull the plug and make some moves for the future.
Yeah, and you mentioned the big reason there is, so Gasol, $24 million this year, $25.5 million next year. Conley, $30.5 million this year, $32.5 million, and then he's got $34.5 million in his final year. Mm-hmm. It's just really tough. I have a piece coming out for Yahoo that'll post later this week. That's the 10 least tradable contracts in the NBA, and unfortunately, Conley features kind of prominently in there. And it's not about the player. You know, people always, you know, oh, Mike Conley Jr. is good. You know, he's really, really good. Yeah, he is really good. Maybe he should be an All Star this year. He makes $34.5 million 2 years from now. Mm-hmm. Like, that's just, you know, that's, you know, completely untenable to carry. And then another Grizzlies, you know, working in there is Chandler Parsons, to step on the piece a little bit, because that's just a mess. But is it time for me, this is 2 years too late. You know, they should have moved on these deals 2 years ago if they could have got something and moved. I really am getting the sense that they might be willing to finally entertain it. I think they're looking at it and saying I just had it up and I think I closed it. But they're 19-27. They're six games out of the eight spot right now. They're done. You know, it's sad as that is, they've lost five in a row, 1-9 in their last 10. The Grizzlies, their season's finished.
They started hot. They did. Yeah, they started hot, but now they're, you know, I think they're right. They are done. But yeah, can they look themselves in the mirror and actually pull that trigger? That's going to be can they even get it? I mean, like you said, it's the contracts. It's not necessarily the player. There are a ton of teams that would love to have Marc Gasol, love to have Mike Conley. You know, you look at what I think one of the worst contracts in the league right now is John Wall. And that's that Supermax. I'm sure he's high up on your list of that Yahoo piece that you've got coming out. So
let's just say, Trevor, he couldn't be higher on the list.
I had a feeling that he was going to be number one on there. So, but then you look at John Wall. Hey, there's a lot of teams that would love to have John Wall. If he was $10 million a year, give me John Wall all day, every day. But that contract makes it tough. And so that's what we always have to consider when we're looking at the trade deadline, is it's not just the player. It's how much they're making.
Yep. Yeah, that's exactly it. And what people, I think, forget is, so let's just use your team as an example. Let's use the Lakers. Let's say they wanted to make a run at Marc Gasol. You know, yeah, he'd be a phenomenal fit for them. You know, he'd be fantastic to hold down the middle. But he makes $24 million a year. So you're talking about having to cobble together two, three, maybe even four guys to go get that. And we just spent the first half of this show talking about how banged up and injured they are. Now they need depth. So now all of a sudden you're selling off all your depth to go there. You're not the Warriors, who are going to say, here's our 6, 7, 8 guys in the playoffs, beat them. So if we add one, like, off we go. You know, this is a team where you've got to have some more depth. So that becomes the problem. And that's just using the Lakers as an example. But that example works for any team in the NBA. Whenever a guy makes 20 plus million, you're probably going to have to put together somewhere in the range of two or three contracts to make that trade. That's why those trades always happen in the summertime, you know, around the NBA draft, when it's much easier to do that. Because the last thing you want to do to your coach is, hey, coach, just traded for Marc Gasol. Oh, that's great. We got Marc Gasol. What do we give up? Well, I gave up one starter and four bench players. All of a sudden, the coach is like, what am I supposed to do with this? Right. Like, now, I mean, that's cool. I get this guy, but I don't have anybody else behind him. So that becomes the problem. That's where that's always goes back to, you got to keep that thought in the back of your head, because as much as everybody loves, you know, guys like Marc Gasol, it's going to cost you to get there, not necessarily in terms of what you give up, just in terms of depth.
Yeah, absolutely. There's so many different factors to take a look at. I mean, plus having to throw guys in and make them learn the system, you know, in the middle of the season, that's not easy. Chemistry issues, all of that can make things tough. I still think, though, it's going to be an interesting trade deadline. I think somebody's going to surprise us. I think somebody's going to either talk themselves into being a playoff team and make a big swing that they may end up missing on, or that somebody's going to go the other way and somebody that we think is almost in it is going to pull the plug.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think, you know, we'll see that. One thing I always do try to remind people, too, is NBA teams have gotten really smarter over the last, I'll say, about 5 years, where if they're interested in a player, they don't wait until the trade deadline. It used to be you kind of waited and waited and waited. Mm-hmm. Look at what Philadelphia did with Jimmy Butler. Now, Butler hit a spot where he had to go, but what they did was they jumped on it and jumped on it then. And said, you know what, let's make this happen. Let's give ourselves enough time, because they knew there was going to be bumps in incorporating Butler. And, you know, we're gonna hit a little bit of a rocky road with this, but let's give ourselves enough time to figure this out and get to a good place. You saw that with Trevor Ariza. The Phoenix Suns moved quickly to make that trade. And in Washington, you know, now they've kind of climbed back in it. So maybe, you know, that'll be the right thing for them down the line. But yeah, I always look at it as, you know, well, because let's say nothing really happens, we're all going to sit around on that Thursday and, you know, refresh Twitter 5 million times and, right, you know, yep, be ready to go. And then
waiting for the Woj bombs.
Yeah. And then it's going to be something like Lakers acquire Shelvin Mack for a second round pick. And it's going to be like, great. You know, this is
fireworks.
I spent my whole day on this. And then I, you know, want to remind people, like, yeah, but we already saw Jimmy Butler get traded, and we saw all these things happen already this season. You know, build it into one thing. But, you know, hey, I'm with you. I'm there too, fans. I get, you know, sit there and I'm like, oh, what's happening? What's going on with this? And, you know, and then nothing happens, and I feel like I wasted my day. So I get it.
Well, I mean, hey, we did have that 1 year, gosh, what was it, 3-4 years ago, where Woj just gave up and tweeted, "Good Lord," because yes, just that dam burst, and there was just this deluge of trades happening. So you never know.
The last hour.
Yes, all within the last hour. Like, he couldn't keep up with all of it. So you never know what's going to happen. Just to drill down real quick into the Lakers side of it, I think the challenge for them is that they're really trying to accomplish three things at one time. And that's that they're trying to preserve cap space for next summer, so they can go after KD, they can go after Kawhi, they can go after all those guys. They're trying to win right now and make the playoffs. And they're trying to maintain enough tradable assets to potentially put together a package for Anthony Davis. And trying to do all three of those things at once is extremely difficult. And I think that could be somewhat paralyzing, to the point where the only real option for them is to do kind of a small move. So I'm not expecting a big move out of them. But, you know, Magic Johnson and Rob Pelinka have made deals at the last two trade deadlines. So if history is our guide, I think they do something. But I'm not expecting the big splash this year.
Yeah, that's exactly where I am. I would be stunned if any of the, let's call it, primaries in a potential Anthony Davis trade, so Ball, Ingram, Hart, Kuzma, if any of them were dealt this year, I would be completely stunned. That would just blow me away. It's not anything I'm expecting to see from the Lakers. I think it's going to be, you know, we've been talking about this, it feels like all the way since last summer, about how they pivoted after they didn't get that second star and said, all right, bunch of guys to tradable contracts that only last a year. And they did that for a reason. And now we're going to start to see that come to fruition here, where it's, you know, Beasley, Stevenson, you know, it's not going to be Rondo now because now they need him.
Right.
But, you know, those were the guys. And then if, you know, if they can work the right deal and Kentavious Caldwell-Pope has to go somewhere and waive that no trade clause, all right, you know, then off we go. Maybe they can figure that out. So that's the thing as I look at it with the Lakers. I'm with you. They're going to do something. I just wouldn't hold my breath waiting on a blockbuster, because I think they're trying to set up for their blockbuster is going to come over the summer. That's what they're shooting for more. Now it's exactly what you said. It's make a small move to keep us in this race, but let's not do anything to hurt our flexibility going forward.
Right. And I mean, Magic Johnson set this up last summer. He said, this year we're back. Next year we're back. We know this is very much a two-year plan here, and that they're probably going to make their big move during the summer and not right now. Of course, now that I said that, they're going to go swing for the fences and bring in somebody. But anyway, Keith, I think we covered a ton of stuff here on the trade deadline, on Lonzo, on Carmelo Anthony, and everything else. And I just want to say thank you, man, for coming on here and joining me. Really, really appreciate it.
Yeah, of course. And one thing I will say, if history, recent sports history tells us anything, it'll be Celtics Lakers come June, because I think Boston and LA are now destined to compete for titles here. Red Sox, Dodgers, Patriots, Rams. It's, you know, and, you know, I know all your listeners and a large chunk of my following, we'd be just fine with that. You know, I think the rest of the NBA would be like, again with this, you know, but, right. But you know, hey, if it's that way every June, hey, we're happy, right?
Oh, yeah, we'll take it. Absolutely. So, let's keep the rivalry going. Let's keep this thing rolling. And we'll roll it across all different sports. Hey, let's even get the Galaxy or LAFC against the Revolution in there. So you never know. All right, Keith, can you tell everybody where you can find your work? And then, of course, you already mentioned you've got your piece coming up on the least tradable contracts.
Yeah, for sure. You can find most of my written work now at yahoo.com. One of the things that it went out last week was the 10 most tradable contracts. And a lot of people were like, this is a stupid list. These guys would never get traded. Well, yeah, they wouldn't. But it's more of a, these are how great these contracts are.
Right.
So you can check that out. The companion piece, the 10 least tradable contracts, that'll go up later this week. Look for more trade deadline preview stuff, buyers and sellers for each conference. We're going to kind of go in depth on those. And then coming out of that, it'll be, you know, really, that's when I start to, obviously I'm still watching and, you know, getting excited for the playoffs, but I start to turn my eyes towards the off season and the off season planning. So we've got some cool stuff in the works for that. Over at Real GM, I put out an updated cap space preview going for projected cap space for all 30 teams. There will be an update for that following the trade deadline that will come out. So you can definitely check that out. And then if you're interested, probably most of your listeners aren't, but if you're interested in some Celtics specific coverage, everything over at Celtics blog over there from me. But, you know, beyond that, it's always fun to join you guys. I love the show, and I'm, you know, happy to be on whenever you need me.
Well, thanks, Keith. Yeah, let's do this again real soon. Always appreciate you coming on here and chatting, man.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I know this is going to go up a little later today, but this is one of the more fun days of basketball on the calendar. You got hoops all day long here on the Martin Luther King holiday. It's, you know, I really look forward to this day every year, and glad I've, you know, going to settle in here. It's only 30 degrees here in Orlando today. So I'm definitely staying in the house all day long and watching basketball.
Hey,
to be honest with you, if it was 75 degrees, that's what I was going to do anyway. But now I have an excuse.
Exactly. Not a bad way to spend your day. That's what I'm hoping to do as well. So yeah, I'm gonna get this edited and send it out there. So hopefully this gets out before something happens with Carmelo Anthony, since we just talked about it.
Absolutely right.
All right, guys, and hey, make sure you go follow Keith on Twitter at KeithSmithNBA. Don't forget to head over to LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. Go download the Robinhood app. Go check out Lakers.Robinhood.com. Get free stock. Go check that out. I'm a huge supporter of them. And guys, don't forget to check out the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Support Lakers Nation on Instagram at Lakers Nation Official. You can find us on Twitter at Lakers Nation, on Facebook at the Lakers Nation Facebook page. And don't forget to check out the Lakers Nation postgame show. I go on live usually with Jas Kang, and we do a full postgame show on Facebook Live after every Lakers game. After losses, we get to come on and vent. We get to celebrate after victories. So come join in the fun. You guys get to comment, and we respond to your comments live on Facebook. So come check it out, the Lakers Nation postgame show on Facebook after every single game. That's going to wrap things up for today, guys. My name is Trevor Lane. You can follow me on Twitter at Trevor_Lane. Till next time, see ya.